now a fully certified leader, and who has made it his calling here as a leader to put together these community circles, these sharing circles. And as you most noticed before, I thank John for waking us up. Here's another wake up. We've got the wrong title of his program here, but guess what? It's okay. Because it reminds us of what we heard before, and we are going to welcome him to talk with us about the communities we make. Because we do. We create these communities. Some of us come into communities that are already made, but we know, especially in a community like this one, that although it has existed since 1876, we are renewing this community every day with every new member who comes in, with every new leader who joins us. And so thank you, Richard, for helping us to consider that notion about the communities we make.
Thank you, Anne. Thank you, everybody. And again, it's always a delight to be here. This has become so much my home. And it's true. I was going to mention that the title has moved on to the communities we make. And that was really the question to ponder when we begin. And so different from last week's program and from many programs where we talk about social issues, today I want to talk really about us. That's to say about the ethical society and the kind of community we are and the community that we make. How it's formed, who makes it, and how our members are supported in turn. So the way people choose to become members of a community instead of, say, other communities, about the society's place, of course, in the larger world. So I was trying to remember if there was ever a time in my life when I was kind of without community. And I guess there really was a time. There was a time when I left the country, and I lived in another country for a couple of years, and while it wasn't a place of hardship, there was kind of a distinction. The cultural difference, the language difference, really made a wall between me and the rest of society, is the way I experienced it. And eventually I decided I'd come back, because I really missed community. And the first thing that struck me about being home, strangely enough, was to see people in uniform, like policemen, and they spoke my language. I could talk to them. That was really amazing. And it really is a reflection about what it must really be like as a refugee, someone who has no choice to return, and someone who is sort of landed up on a strange shore and has to cope and reconstruct some kind of community. It's really a challenge. Well, what makes a community? I mean, there's the natural community of their family and the first environment that you grow up in. I grew up on Long Island in Nassau County. And after high school graduation, I moved on and I never really went back. It's not that far away, it's just like out there. But I remember there was one time, years later, I had a meeting in an office building back in my town of East Meadow on Long Island. And I overhear some secretaries chatting, and they have this like nasal atmosphere, and nasal voice, and I'm thinking, that's my language, these are my paisana, you know, I'm really home, you know. You know, imagine how fine we chop this, you know. So Middle Nassau County is my location, you know, that's where I come from. And of course, there are these circumstantial communities, obviously, you know, your job situation, your colleagues. And we create a community, and of course, part of modern notions of management is to form community, to get the people to form a kind of bond. It's not like the old days where there was a top-down authoritarian notion of management. Today, the group is considered to be appropriate when it's a team. So communities are made. And of course, there's a national identity, being American, and in some ways, we're actually fighting over what that identity is, because we all have a strong sense of what that identity ought to be. So what's a natural community? I think of the natural village, the classic village. So that's partially circumstantial. You're born into it. You have no option. That's where you emerge. It's partly natural because you grow up in this atmosphere that's sort of suffused with this culture. The people around you, they drink the same water, they speak the same language, and you might accept or reject the individuals around you, but you share something really deep. You share this origin. So the village really serves as a model of the natural and classic community that births you, it nurtures you, it supports you as you go through life. There's certainly going to be elements that are annoying and maybe even dangerous, even though it's your community. But a natural community has one of everything, right? It'll have the village elder, it'll have the village idiot. There's the one everyone looks up to and the one that everyone knows never to trust. There's the one who gathers the kids for a Saturday softball game. And there's the ones who the kids avoid, right? I'm going to change my glasses. That's better. So a whole village of people, moms, teachers, butchers, lawyers, farmers, carpenters, they're all necessary to operate an economy, and they're all necessary to comprise a community. For most of human existence, people lived in groups or tribes of around 100 and 150. This is what we are presuming now. These are people who really knew each other intimately. And it's from that long-term experience, talk about millions of years, before the era of agriculture and settlement into permanent habitations, it's that our brains have been hardwired, really, to need a communal structure within which to thrive. It also hardwired us to be able to accommodate basically a maximum of about 150 people, the size of that original tribe. At any given time. A normal person, it seems, really can't know many more people than that. But that's the tribal communal structure. It's really built into us. So while we've had in our country, in the United States, a mythology built upon the idea of self-reliance, independence as a style of life, at the same time, American culture was always characterized by a special capacity for people to organize themselves, beginning as strangers, and organize themselves into functional and cooperative groups and organizations, groups of common interests or goals or ideals, in the same way, recreating a village. Alexander de Tocqueville wrote about this back in the 1830s and found it to be a uniquely American trait and a necessary building block for democratic institutions. He saw that people in America would form voluntary associations of anything, say, milk producers, animal husbandry improvement associations, quilting bees, chess players, library associations, all non-governmental associations. And these groups serve to organize communities by forming networks. So this is like a civil architecture that underlies a practical and effective democracy. So when political movements arose out of people's concerns, de Tocqueville found that people were already organized and they were networked. So they were competent and effective to organize for political purposes. In other countries, it's not really always like that. You know, in some traditional European businesses, they much rather hire relatives, really relatives, cousins, nephews, you know. Rather than go to strangers. But in the United States, we have this capacity to put strangers together and form them into a team. It's really a trait we have. So these are intentional, voluntary communities built around shared interests, like clubs, or here, the Ethical Society. So in the era of urban life, huge metropolises, impersonal cities, can the intimate community be recreated? Can you build a village in the middle of New York City? Can you create a village with a small town familiarity and its structure of mutual support? So what about our society? How are we doing? So this ethical society, it's a community of people who come together with intentionality, right, over common interests, who seek an organic community like a village. So how does it work? Oops. It's organized as a non-for-profit corporation and a membership organization. So membership is not entirely casual. It's actually a legal significance. Membership is the foundation of this organization. It's democratically run in that the members make the fundamental decisions about the direction, the mission, the purpose of the organization, and therefore of the community that it comprises. Members vote for the board of directors, vote for changes to the bylaws. These are all procedural things that really create the networks. Society is really defined by its members. But it's also a living community that grows, it evolves, and it fulfills a role in the lives of the members, and it impacts the world at large. If it does not do that, it will lose its reason for being. We want to see here how the society can best fulfill that double mission, serving its members, reaching out to the world with continued renewal and growth. So today we're going to recognize our newest members after our platform, those who've chosen to join in the last year or so. So we want to welcome them again. We'll have a luncheon afterwards upstairs. And we want to make sure that the older members meet them and have an opportunity to welcome them into the fold. So it's since we collectively comprise a community, and for it to work, we have to build the networks and the ties that link us together. Well, our society has a storied past, of course, and a collective memory. We often recount the projects and the causes that were championed by the society over the years, and we certainly should celebrate the history and the people behind it. We have heroes, those many members who gave special energy, inspiration, support to make this society come alive with purpose and with impact. In the 19th century, there were the Seligmans, the Wolfs, the Sutros. In the early 20th century, the Kahns, Davids, the Blumenthals, and many, of course, shall we say, the latter-day saints of today, right? So what are we? What is this entity? We promote and engender social causes, but we're not a social service organization per se, right? We support the environment, but we're not an environmental organization. We support women's rights, racial justice, mental health, voting rights, stronger democracy. We support the polar bears. Hey, right? But we're not a lobbying group. We're not organized to promote one particular cause or another. The society is not, strictly speaking, a pressure group for any one of these causes. What the society does support and what it does promote is the human experience. We see that the whole human being is nourished by all of these claims, these rights, and these values. We recommend these causes to the world, and we will undertake to live our values in our own lives, to be exemplars of these values in the way we aim to live. We always describe the society as a community, so we should ask from time to time, are we succeeding at it? Are we doing what we can do, what we need to do, in order to create a living community? Function as a real village? Or is there more that we can and that we should do? There's no question that community is needed in the world today. Our era is sometimes described as a unique time of separation, of loneliness, and individual isolation. So how can that be? We live in a time of social media, of friends, social networks. So I put friends in air quotes, because they're not all friends, right? I mean, the word friend's been co-opted by the commercial interests of Facebook and other multi-billion-dollar corporations that leverage our social networks for their marketing schemes. Hey, over the years, there's been, amazingly, a tangible and measurable decline in social ties, those social connections that make for a healthy, humane environment, that make for community. One way this can be seen is in the vast increase in the number of people who live alone. 100 years ago, about 5% of the households in our country were composed of one person. Now that number has increased to about 1 in 4. So that's really amazing. Similarly, the number of people who report that they have no one to talk to has increased to an amazing degree. Now, 100 years ago, surveys showed that about 3% of the population reported that they could name no one with whom they would be able to discuss a personal matter. Today, that number is said to be more than 25%. So people just feel separated. Family members live far apart as college admissions and job opportunities draw us to the four corners of the country, if not the world. And a growing dilemma among older adults is what they're now calling the orphan elderly, those who are aging with no close relations or none living nearby who can participate in their lives. The household of the three or four generations living together in the old homestead is a relic of a bygone era. Our answer is to professionalize the care of our aging population, to give it up to paid strangers, because our natural modern age community, the nuclear family, is often just inadequate to provide the ongoing communal supports that they once did. Many of you may remember the book came out several years ago by Robert Putnam called Bowling Alone. In it, he documented the diminishment of all kinds of voluntary groups, most emblematically, the bowling league. They were once so popular. He described how the sinews and ligature of society is shriveling, and with it, participatory democracy. Voting participation is diminishing like crazy. So they're not taking the trouble, people just not joining voluntary associations. They're not taking the trouble to do the necessary work of building social organizations, making the coffee, showing up for the meetings. Does it sound familiar? It's like, where is everybody? People seem to be just staying at home. So is it the vast number of entertainment options that we now have at home today? Everyone's busy with his and her own device. The picture of Thanksgiving dinner with everybody's head down over his own smartphone is like the cartoon of our day, right? Ordinarily, all these grassroots, Tea Party, feminist, anti-abortion, environmental, Second Amendment, folk dancing, craft beer drinking groups should form the tapestry of our whole community. Well, those that do organize amid all those folks who stay at home, well, they're the ones who are setting the political agendas, aren't they? They're the ones who do show up. There also seems to be the calculation that people make about what do I get out of it? So no one should spend their time for no reason, of course, but too much of a consumer culture seems to encourage people to judge membership from a consumer's paradigm, am I getting as much satisfaction out of this activity rather than through another? Well, there's also the element of mission and goals, right? One's participation can also be measured by how much of an impact can I make? Some people express fear that our national community has lost its foundational idea. The idea that America, that held us together, the idea of America that held us together as a country through wars and depressions, bad times and good times. In last week's platform address, Joe Schumann described his observation that the idea that helped define America is really being discarded in our time. In the past couple of weeks, if you followed, David Brooks in the New York Times wrote about the same thing. They're both saying that the underlying narrative that has defined America and that's been shared by people of all political stripes seems to be dissolving. The ideals of respect for different views, different religions, a freedom of expression and support for the downtrodden, the value of investment in society, value of world leadership, these ideals are being supplanted by a new breed of selfishness and divisiveness. With the loss of these binding definitions, the national community looks like it's coming apart. We can see changes. Well, we in this society really have to claim our place and our voice in this time of lost vision. We in the secular, evidence-based, humanist, progressive part of the spectrum, that's us, we have a perspective, a life stance, and a philosophy to offer in which we value the worth and dignity of each person and support equality, justice, and acknowledge our duty to future generations. We're also entitled to our own organizations and our own voice in the public sphere. So our message is entitled to be heard by the larger world, and it takes an institution and an organized community really to accomplish that. So what is our challenge? What undermines the vitality of community really is apathy. Apathy is the dilemma of our time. A sense that one's own contribution doesn't really matter, that the challenges are too great for any one person or any group to solve. So to contradict this, we only have to look back to our own heroes, the Seligmans, the Kahns, the Sutros, and to the more recent and current members who led the society and impacted the lives of the people of this city. The times really need us to look out for each other, to nurture and support our own community, and to reach out to help America regain its rightful direction, its role as a leader of humanity, to recapture its soul. There are things we need to do right now for ourselves and for others. One way that our community will work is by intentionally regenerating the methods and practices of a true village, a village in which we look out for each other. So through the coordination, say, of our caring committee, members have reached out to others who've been homebound, hospitalized, or ailing. Can this happen without a formal community? Yeah, I mean, neighbors help each other, but with intention and with purpose, people can effectively help each other in a voluntary, intentional community like ours by exercising these programs that we've created. We have to look and see who hasn't been around and who should be called. We need to remember to speak up when we know someone is in need so we can get in gear and reach out. And as you know, the contact people for the caring committee include Bob Berger, the co-chairperson, and of course any of the leaders, a short route to go. The community exists here in the society to offer a forum for our views and ideas, a sounding board to test your ideas. Here is a place you can come to first to see if others will share your ideas, say, for new programs, new causes. Here is a natural starting place for a new idea, a new movement. I'm thinking of the group, for example, the Wisdom and World Affairs with Abe Markman and Ken Gans. There's the leader lunch groups and our reading groups, or there could be a new format that someone may have an idea for. And of course, every Sunday, we have the lunchroom upstairs, which is a place to chat and to talk and to bounce ideas across. Early in the year, we started the new community circles as small discussion groups where people share their thoughts and views on how we ought to live and cope in today's world. Two circles have been meeting since early this year, and we can start a third one if more people want to join. I invite you to do that. These circles provide a terrific opportunity for a rich, deep, and thoughtful sharing that's just not available elsewhere. There are other projects that are ongoing and which serve vulnerable populations, as you all know, and I'm about to remind you. Operating through the SSB, there's the homeless shelter, which always needs more volunteers to monitor it overnight. Those of you who've been involved, I'm sure have heard the gratitude of the women who rely on it. The supportive televisiting program is now looking for a volunteer to help several hours a week in the office. So I'm hopeful that someone can find a few hours during the week to do that. There's the elder, the Ethical Elders Program, which has the lecture series for older adults, the caregivers, social workers, and right now is developing its program for 2018. It's reaching out to the membership for suggestions, programs, so come up with your ideas or the things that you feel are needed. There's the Environmental Stewardship Committee and collaborators like Food and Water Watch, 350 NYC, and other groups through which we must actively promote the need for environmental sustainability. These are channels for our message to go out. Who imagined that all the progress everyone struggled for would slip backward like it has? Maybe it's like the darkness before the dawn, you know? Maybe it was necessary. This is really the tenement reform movement, the settlement house movement, and the child labor movement of our day. It's really the salvation of the earth, I mean, you know. So it's positively apocalyptic. There's self-development as we strive to become more in touch, more mindful, such as through the colloquies, the ethical enrichment programs, and the Ethical Action Committee is organizing to be a clearinghouse for actions and activities by which we all can get engaged. Next Sunday, for example, is International Human Rights Day, and we're teaming up with Amnesty International Group 280 for a write-a-thon to write letters to help release prisoners of conscience. And right now, on the table in the back under the Ethical Action Board are two letters which you're invited to look at and to sign and send in. One is to New York State Assembly to pressure it to pass a bill now stuck in committee to limit solitary confinement as a practice in correctional facilities. And the other one is to Police Commissioner O'Neill to encourage him to really, really stop the broken windows program. So I invite you to look back there. Look, there'll be another Women's Day march in January, and there'll be a million ways to mobilize opposition to federal plans to undermine women's health, children's health, the whole earth's health. To remain aloof in the face of war, famine, and authoritarianism, I mean, the country appears to be losing its conscience. And as the ethical society, it really is our obligation to help restore it. There's a lot going on and so much to do. We can be grateful for those who came before and built this community and its reputation for progressive thought and action, which we have inherited. And we can honor their creativity best by carrying it forward, doing the work that we've been called to do today. Hopefully, this group will still be here 141 years from now, still vibrant, still relevant, still an inspiration to the city and beyond, still a home and a caring village for its members. Thanks.